All right. This one I gotta get out and show you where I'm at. I need a sign to let me know you're here. All of these lines are being crossed over the atmosphere. I need to know if things are gonna go. So this is what I'm looking at today, as I'm gonna record my next Uncle Thornton video. All you angels. Talk about my Uncle Thornton. He is really funny, man. My Uncle Thornton, he walked in a room, he took over and just got everybody laughing. I've said this a few times, even to him, that, I mean, I will post a picture, unless I hear otherwise in the next week or so, I'll post a picture of my Uncle Thornton, because he looked like he would have been one of the Monty Python, you know, flying circus guys, man. He looks exactly like those guys. It was like, every time, even today, I see a picture of him, I see a man, I go, you Monty Python, man. And it's kind of, you know, I don't know. So my Uncle Thornton, you know, younger brother, I guess he was a better swimmer than my dad. That's what Dave Dow was telling me. And like, I didn't know that, you know. I mean, swimming is in our blood, music is in our blood. I got swimming, I didn't get the music bud, you know, blood gene, whatever. You know, my Uncle Thornton, you know, I was told this, that, you know, this is what happened. He graduated high school, and him and Marty, my Aunt Marty, got married, and they're still married. And he went up to Oregon State University. And I mean, he, you know, his mom, his aunt, and his grandfather have graduated U of O, and he goes to Oregon State. I mean, that seems kind of, you know, treacherous, treasonous, you know, stab in the back. I don't know. No, I mean, it's like, you know, and growing older and gaining wisdom. God, I love that song. Anyway, gaining wisdom, and, you know, it's like, Thornton, you know, what he probably did was he just, you know, he saw the insanity of whatever his, you know, growing up and just got out. And, you know, Marty, I think her dad was a doctor. They had money and, you know, they put him through school. And, you know, I going, you know what, Thornton, I texted him one time. I'm going, that was, you know, that probably the smartest thing you ever did was, you know, you found a good woman. I mean, a really good woman. And, you know, went to the Oregon State, and he got picked up by Pacific Northwest Bell, and he worked for them, retired. I mean, I loved it. He retired from them, and they rehired him as a contractor, paying him like three times as much money. I'm going, you know, good gig if you can get it, man. That's, you know, way to go, Thornton. Living in a glass house on Mercer Island, you know, a couple miles or blocks from Paul Allen. Anyway, I think I was baptized, and Thornton was my godfather. I think that's what I was told. Or, you know, I believe so, because Aunt Linda was Leslie's. So, you know, my earliest memories of Uncle Thornton and Aunt Marty and Cousin Jenny, and, you know, eventually Cousin Amy, was we'd you know, go jam up the 5 freeway, 5-hour drive from Eugene to Renton, Washington, you know, that little, you know, 65 BW Bug. Oh, man, my mom rolled that too, man, later. That's another story. When I get to my mom, I'll talk about that. If I don't, remind me. You know, and I love it because, like, you're driving up and you come across, this is the exact middle between the Arctic and the equator. I mean, there's a sign there that says it. And it's like, you know, it's really cool. I mean, I drive now by it and I go, God, man, you know, 58, 54, you know, 7 years ago, I'm driving by that. Mom's pointing it out and looking at this, you know, and anyway, that's nothing about nothing. Or they would come down to Grandma Gail's house and we'd go over and, you know, do the family thing with them. You know, that was my early memory of, you know, my cousin, you know, Jenny, redhead. Marty was a redhead and freckles, and Jenny, like, multiplied it, I think. I mean, poor girl. And so, you know, she, Amy came along. You know, I got these two cousins. They had moved to Renton. I don't know. I think Thornton was working for, you know, Pacific Northwest Bell. And my dad got a job at Boeing, writing Cobalt, you know, code for, you know, programming. And my dad got an economics degree and then went to, you know, got into writing programs, you know. We moved up there and we stay in the Holiday Inn. We check in. And I, you know what it's like when you check in, you just kind of got to want to unwind and just kind of, like, put your stuff out just a little bit. And us kids, man, we're wanting to go swimming, you know, it's the middle of summer, we're wanting to go swimming. I'm 5 years old, you know, Leslie's 6, I think, you know, Jenny's probably 5 years old too. I think we're the same age. We all go just, you know, running off to the pool, you know, and somehow get in. I don't know how, you know, back in them days. And, you know, Leslie jumps off the diving board, swims to the side. Jenny jumps off the diving board, swims to the side. And I jumped off the diving board, and I don't know how to swim. And I'm just standing there. I mean, just, you know, my head's not going above water. I'm swallowing water. I'm, you know, just, I'm going to die. And, you know, all of a sudden, I feel this thing around me, and, you know, it's my Uncle Thornton, you know, pulling me to the side, and, you know, I think he did, you know, like, put me on my side and make sure he got all the water out of my lungs, and, you know, because I think my dad was a lifeguard. I don't know if Thornton was, too, but, you know, during summers, that's how they made their money, I believe. Anyway, so, you know, my Uncle Thornton saved my life. Man, I, you know, anybody else could have jumped in and saved me, but it was Uncle Thornton who, you know, jumped in. And, you know, they said that they were in the hotel room and, you know, we took off and Thornton's going, you know, I probably should go keep an eye on the kids. And he came out and saved me right in time, man. That was... You know, and it's funny because I have absolutely no fear of water. You know, I had none whatsoever. I was, you know, on a swim team. I, you know, water, I love water, boats, you know. You see what view I'm looking at now, you know, that this is the Hood Canal Bridge. And out there, you know, to the right, you go up a couple miles, it's the Bangor Submarine Base. And how many billions and billions and billions of dollars of submarines have gone through here? My father-in-law, my ex-father-in-law, used to work at, he was an inspector on the nuclear reactors on the submarines. And he would talk about, they had navigation so down, is what they do, is they would go like 10 feet from the dock, submerge, and they would travel all the way out under the Hood Canal Bridge, through the Straits of Juan de Fuca, and out in the Pacific Ocean, and, you know, underwater the whole way. I looked it up. The Straits of Juan de Fuca are 900 feet deep from the opening to Whidbey Island. So, you know, it just amazes me they have this floating bridge here. And, you know, I have seen 6 submarines come back in, you know, 6 Bangor submarines come back in. And it's interesting because they do come in and they have these 2 really, really nice, I mean, probably almost as expensive as the sub, no, but, you know, tugs that, you know, escort them in, and they come back in on the surface, you know. And I'm like, wow, you know, if one's coming in, another must be going out, I mean, I would think. But anyway, so this is kind of a cool spot. I went down to Silverdale today. I'm getting off from Uncle Thornton, but I've been thinking about him all day. But I went down to Silverdale to get my iPhone screen fixed. It was all chipped and stuff. The guy pulls it out of the case, pulls the cover off the screen. My phone is absolutely perfect. You know, $30. He puts another cover on it. I mean, I could do it myself. I'll do that next time. And my phone's perfect. Didn't cost me a thing. You know, I got my iPad that I'm recording on here is all messed up. I have to get it fixed, and he's gonna get parts on Monday. So I'm coming back down here, and I always stop here when I'm driving through here, and you know, driving back to Squim. Anyway, I got off on that. This is beautiful to me, you know, and this water and where it goes. You turn left and you can go anywhere in the world, you know, in my mind and my seafaring. And I'm like, 30-foot seas, yeah. Tell Madeline about Madeline's story of 40-foot seas with her husband. We were living in Seattle. We were living off of the main runway of SeaTac Airport. We were like 2 miles away. I mean, planes are 2,000 feet, 2,500 feet coming over us. I mean, these jets, you know, 747s and just all of them, you know, 707s back then. And you got used to it, you know. Thornton and Marty and, you know, them were living in Renton. And so they were close. So, I mean, I'm sure my dad and him drank a lot of beer together. And, you know, we got together, family things. I remember my mom was pregnant with Peter. He was born in 1967. September 67, and we're sitting at Thornton Marty's kitchen table, and my mom's water broke, and, you know, she's sitting there smoking a cigarette, and it's like, you know, God, man. And so she goes to the hospital, has Peter, and, you know, I'm thinking, man, Pete's coming home, and I'm gonna, you know, he gets big enough, we're gonna have fisticuffs and stuff. And he was always so much littler than me that I never could, you know. I mean, I could, you know, I teased him mercilessly. I was horrible to him. Well, you know, he owed it. He deserved it because of that thing on my eye, man. Little turd. So anyway, God, I remember when Peter came home from Navy boot camp. I saw him, and he was buffed out. You know, they work you in there. And he goes, I'm thinking, oh, man, he's going to kick my ass. I mean, I know he just is like all those years, all those times that I tormented him and, you know, was merciless to him. And, you know, no, he goes, I want to arm wrestle you. And I'm going, in my mind, I'm going, John, you break your arm before you let your little brother beat you. And I beat him. I mean, you know, it wasn't a problem. I was like, oh man, you know, I was going to break my arm before my little brother, you know, beat me arm wrestling. Anyway, so, you know, Pete was born, you know, from there. Not a lot of other things. Maybe come up later, I'll talk about, you know, things that come up. We were living in Connecticut, and I was 11 years old, so that would have been 1972. And we came out, we drove up to Buffalo to the Parrots. The Nick Parrott stayed with them. They drove us up into Canada. He had this big old boat, Cadillac too. He loved Cadillacs. That's all he ever bought. But he drives us up to what's the city north? Whatever city's in Canada's north of off the top of my mind, because I got the Quetico, and that's, you know, anyway. And so we fly across Canada on Air Canada, you know, to Vancouver, and, you know, Thornton and Marty pick us up. I don't remember if Jenny or Amy were with us. And the one thing I remember that is that we did get earphones, and you could listen to that song America, you know, the horse with no name. I remember played that over and over and over again. I still like the song. So anyway, we land, you know, they pick us up. We go to Thornton and Marty had a summer cabin, or just another house out on Whidbey Island. It was on this big bay, they're up in the house partying, you know. I think they were getting stoned. I'm sure my dad wasn't, but they were, you know. My dad was drinking beer. He always had beer. If I ever drank his last beer, man, I did that once in my life. I never did that again. So, you know, that trip, that a couple of things stand out. Number one, they had like this little 8-foot plastic dinghy boat, you know. I mean, the sides were flimsy, and, You had two paddles, and, you know, two at a time we'd go out there, and I don't even think we had life vests on, and we're paddling, you know, quarter mile from shore, just, you know, messing around in the Straits of Juan de Fuca. It's like really cool. I guess when they got home, when we got home from the airport, when we got there, they had a gallon of wine, and they put it in the freezer to get it cold, and it froze all the liquid in it, all the water. And they drank what was left, and they just got hammered. I mean, it was just like, here we are. Leslie's 12, I'm 11, you know, Jenny's 11, Amy's, I don't know, 8, 9, you know, Pete's 6 years younger than me, so he's 5, you know, and they're just up there getting just... No, I won't tell that story, Thornton, about your mom being pissed at you when you went to visit her one time. Anyway, so let me get back to my list here of... I, you know, I'll come up with other stories and I'll mention it, but my next thing is... Jenny... got accepted to the University of Oregon. I mean, you know, that's a fourth generation, man. You know, God bless you, you know, Jenny. I'm glad you did that. I'm glad, you know, I should have. You know, Leslie's told me, John, you're the one that should have. And it's, you know, that life didn't go that way. That's just all I'm going to say about it. You know, it's good, bad, or nothing. If it had gone that way, I never would have met Madeline. You know, I did what I was supposed to do. So anyway, you know, she's... getting into her dorm, and you know, it's funny, it was cool because Leslie lived at Campbell House, which was a student co-op, so you know paid whatever and you were part owner while you were there. And they had opened a Janet K. Smith house, and I was one of the, you know, probably the 15th, you know, 20th person to move in out of like, they held probably 35, just these great big houses that they built for, you know, all these bedrooms so kids, you know, go to school. And anyway, so Thornton is going out and he's buying all this, you know, school supplies that you need for Jenny. And this hit me today. And my dad did the same thing for me. And he realized, I mean, Jenny was prepared for it. She was, you know, done the SAT, done all the tests. I mean, just, she was ready for it. And I wasn't. I was a high school dropout. I was going to Lane Community College. That's a great story, my high school diploma. I'll get to that. So my dad does the same thing for me. And I can see in his demeanor. I know my dad really well because I'm really, really like him. And I can see that he realized that, you know, here, you know, Thornton's going out with Jenny and setting her up for success. And he's going out and setting me up for who knows what, you know. And the thing that hit me, you know, today was... my dad was so generous with me the rest of his life. One time, I'm going, Dad, I'm going to buy a car. And, you know, he goes, I didn't need the money. My pool business, I'm doing 65 pools. I'm making, you know, $4,500 a month, you know, and Misty's working, you know, and so I can afford it. And he goes, here, let me send you $3,000. And I'm going, okay. And I bought my Ford Ranger, which I wish I hadn't turned in. But if I... hadn't turned it in, I would have stayed doing pools and I'd be dead now. That's a whole nother story I'll get into. So, you know, my dad, I think he felt really bad about, you know, doing that to me, like not setting me up. Our cousin, God, what's his name? He was Juanita's older brother, Nels, came to visit us when I was in third grade living in Groton, and he was going to Princeton. And I'd like to go to Princeton. I would like to go to Princeton. I don't want to go to Yale. I don't want to go to Harvard. I would like to go to Princeton. And, you know, just, I think he slept on our couch for like 3 days and that's all he did, you know, bastard. I had these really stupid, you know, tennis shoes that my mom had bought me and I didn't like them and I'm wearing them, walking funny in them so I could, you know, and I mentioned that to him and he went and narked me out to my mom. You know, I was like, thanks a lot, Nels, idiot. Anyway, so my dad, you know, he realized that he didn't, you know, set me up for that success that, you know, Jenny was set up for. I used to be around, you know, as a family, even back when my parents were married, and, you know, get around Thornton and Marty and Ginny and Amy, and my mom and my dad and Leslie and Peter and myself, and I, you know, we'd go home or they'd go home, and I knew that they were going home to a family of love, and I wasn't. You know, I always knew that in the bottom of my heart, Thornton, that, you know, you loved your kids, man. When you quit smoking because you didn't want Ginny to smoke, you didn't want your kids to smoke, so you quit smoking. That, I mean, think my parents would ever do anything like that for me? You know, no, that's, you know, but that's, you know, kudos to you, Thornton. I thought that was, you know, even though I was the one stealing your cigarettes back then along with Ginny, you knew that. Oh, anyway, so I, it's funny, I just thought about that my dad, that's why my dad was so generous with me later in life, you know, and it's like, thanks, Dad, you know, I appreciate you, you know, he got sober and he made amends, and, you know, it's like, you make amends, you don't do it again, so. These guys are driving by with two ocean kayaks, man, I want an ocean kayak. This is what you can get me for my birthday. Anyway, no, I don't need it because I'm taking a road trip next summer. They bought a glass house, like, I don't know, way back when, $150,000, man, and it's, you know, worth $2-3 million now. Like, God, they, it's kind of funny. It was kind of, they joked about it, it was a family joke. You know, you can't throw stones, you live in a glass house, you know, and so. I mean, but I swear the glass was that thick. I mean, it was like it was not going to break. When I was going to Lane and Jenny was going to U of O and Thornton came up, my dad came out, and we're sitting in my room at the co-op house, Janet K. Smith, and my dad had brought his guitar, and Thornton, somebody loaned Thornton a guitar. And they're sitting on my bed, and Thornton's playing lead guitar, and my dad's playing rhythm, man. And they, you know, like, they knew how to do it. It was, you know, I loved, that's one of my memories, you know, my fond memories of my dad is, you know, growing up was playing music. You know, he played guitar in 1969. He bought a D18 Martin guitar for $210, and my mom was pissed. And this thing is, you know, it's, if you... Chris ever post that video, you'll hear it. You know, my dad play. That was, you know, I didn't get the music gene. I got the swimming gene, but I didn't get the music gene. I remember, you know, sitting there, Thornton's giving Ginny crap because she's taking a juggling class. He's like, I did all this, you know, just so you could take a juggling class. You know, I kind of maybe a little bit go into more family dynamics. Now, you know what? Back that was, you know, I was 20 years old. Got sober, 85, went over New Year's Eve to Thornton and Marty's. Peter and I watched that movie. It was the Clint Eastwood one, Pale Rider. You know, where he shoots the five guys and then the one guy six times, whatever. And we watched that ending like, you know, 12 times. I mean, Pete sitting there. Anyway, my uncle, when my grandma died, my grandma died, my dad died in 2003, and we had buried him, took his ashes, he wanted to be cremated, so we buried his ashes on top of his grandmother, and, you know, that I loved that. You know, that's what he wanted, you know, it was really cool. And Thornton, you know, he's the one that brought all that together. He made flyers. He's so organized that way. You know, the Serenity Prayer was on there. God, I remember my grandma's funeral. There's, you know, probably 20, 25 of us standing around, you know, and Thornton let me start off talking, you know, and then it got to Leslie. And she, you know, my dad and AA and, you know, the intervention that we did that we didn't know we did with her, and you know, she's talking, and you know, my grandma's going, you know, I'm not an alcoholic, tell her to shut up, and it just right out like Leslie's talking, man. Leslie kept going, you know, she kept her composure. That was kind of funny, you know, my grandma. We got done with my grandma's funeral in Yoncalla. It's about 45 minutes south of Eugene. And we drove back to Eugene and my uncle had, you know, we went into some restaurant that they were ready for us for, you know, 15, however, 20 people, you know, Juanita, her kids, you know, she's got four boys, and their wives and kids, and God, we had a great pool party that night at the hotel with all these kids. It was probably the last time I really had a sane conversation with my brother. You know, I love my brother. He's a good guy, but he drinks and he's full blown, and that's too bad. But this trip, Thornton had it planned out. And so we come back to Eugene, you know, it's, I don't know, middle afternoon, early afternoon. And we go someplace off the University of Oregon and we park, we all park and we walk up and, you know, he waits for all of us and there's these computer science department of the University of Oregon right there. That's, you know, their main entrance. And he goes, I was born in a duplex. My grandma, you know, my mom owned a duplex right here and I was born in it. And, you know, then my grandma sold it to the University of Oregon and they turned it into the, you know, computer science department. And which, I mean, coincidence, my dad was, you know, he ended up being the systems operator on the 1108. It's the Cray, you know, power computer that locked or Univac, Sperry, Univac, Unisys, you know, whatever their name is, you know, now, he was the one that was keeping the software running. And my dad knew his stuff. I can't wait to get into my dad and talking about him. And, you know, he was a big computer, you know, that was his career. And Thornton goes up to Pacific Northwest Bell and he's a big computer guy, you know, and I just thought that's cool, man. I like that property, you know, is a computer science property at the University of Oregon. We're taking this tour. We walk along. There's a trail through the cemetery right there. Really, really old cemetery. And my uncle tells a story. Uncle Thornton tells a story that there's this one headstone right there on the corner where these two paths, you know, and it's everybody's touched it. So many people have touched it. They walk by that it's worn smooth. You can't read whose name is on it. And Thornton says that he thinks in his research that that was my grandmother's, his mom's grandfather. His name was Pyle. I forget his first name, but his name was Pyle, P-Y-L-E, like Gomer. And he had killed a man down in South El Monte and had fled, went up to Eugene, changed his name, added an O in his name, became Poyle, and then went on from there. My grandmother says, you know, the way she talked about her and her sister, Willetta, because they were twin sisters and they were named Juanita and Willetta. I always thought that was cute. I like that. And they said that if the other one had a daughter, they were going to name him after the other one. So my grandma had four boys. Juanita had a son and two daughters. And so Juanita, that's how Juanita got her name from my grandma. And so, but her and her, she talked about like when they were learning to drive, they were just silly girls and stuff. I mean, just like their dad was like getting really mad at them because they just weren't taking this serious. And, you know, like, well, my grandma's going, why do I need to drive? And my grandma never did drive in her life, I don't think. I mean, she took the bus everywhere in Eugene. Anyway, so, you know, they were jokingly thought that maybe their grandpa Poyle was John Wilkes Booth and had fled to Eugene. And I mean, I doubt that, but I mean, I always thought that was kind of funny. My grandma telling me that, you know, my great, great, great grandfather, take this tour. And, you know, there's a bench there. It's kind of like a moon shape, you know, curved bench. And in the flyer, my Uncle Thornton had put a picture of my grandma, Juanita, and her sister, Willetta, sitting there in their cap and gowns, graduating, you know, on that, as 1932, I believe. And it looked, you know, he goes, look up, and there's that bench, you know, what, 70 years later, however many years later? You know, I thought, you know, that was really cool of Uncle Thornton to put this all together, you know. Although my dad did say that when they grew up, they were living in that duplex, that they used to go running around buildings. They just go in the buildings that they could get into at the University of Oregon. Go, you know, bang on the typewriters. I've been talking to Dave Dow, and my dad was a wild man, and my dad was like that, you know, conservative, you know, Jimi Hendrix talks about, is, you know, that white, you know. Anyway, my dad, I guess, really wasn't that. And that tour, I mean, I loved it. One of the times, might have been one, I think, when my dad died, and Thornton kind of did the same thing, or my grandma died in 2006, and he took us through Yonkala, and our family, you know, he's done this research. He went back to Salt Lake City, him and my Aunt Marty, and they did this research on, you know, the Gale family, and, you know, where they came from, and supposedly, the Gale was at one time the Lord Mayor of London, and the second son wasn't going to inherit anything. I've never really totally understood that. Why does the first one get everything and the second, all the rest just, you know, the crumbs or whatever? I mean, you think you'd be fair a little bit? I don't know. You know, I'm the oldest son, so it doesn't matter.